Are you ready to rewind? Take a nostalgia-filled ride back to a simpler time. It's Acid Wash Memories, a retro pop culture celebration. And now your hosts, Joe Marotta and Michael Quinn.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode number 20 of Acid Wash Memories, a retro pop culture celebration. And today we're talking about Punch-Out. Yes. My name is Joe Marotta, joined by the original Soda Popinski, Michael Quinn. How you doing there, Michael?
Howdy-doody.
Howdy-doody.
Punching.
Yes, punching.
Punching him out.
You are drinking a soda, for the record.
That's me. I'm Soda Popinski. Yeah,
exactly right.
With the hair.
Thank you guys so much for being here, whether you have hair or not. If this happens to be your first time on Acid Wash Memories, you're not immediately put off by this corniness, please subscribe on your favorite podcast app and take a dip into our archives where we have a bunch of other episodes.
The archives.
About all different topics. Each week is something completely different, but one thing it has in common, it is a celebration of retro pop culture.
It's so fascinating. It's so intriguing.
People seem to like it.
People love it.
We're going to keep doing it.
Let's do it.
So thank you guys for being with us here. We will be talking about Punch-Out very shortly, but before we knock that out, why don't you jab on over to Twitter, at AWM Podcast and follow us there on Twitter. You can also, if you have a Facebook account, Some people do.
Just like they still play Punch-Out.
Exactly, Quinn. Save retro.
Yeah.
You can actually join our group on Facebook, which is Acid Washed Memories. And the group is basically an extension of the show where we just talk about, you know, maybe the topic of the week or any retro pop culture memories. People talking about music, sports, all sorts of things.
Whatever they remember, we
got
it.
We got it. So join that group. It is non-confrontational. It's a lot of fun. It's very chill. It's very relaxed over there. Acid Washed Memories on Facebook. But as I mentioned today, we are talking about the Punch-Out franchise.
Yes.
I'm assuming, as I often try to do, that everyone listening has either heard of or more than likely played at least one game in the Punch-Out franchise.
And I would hope so.
What's great about the franchise is that there are games from the early 80s that people maybe that were born in the 70s or even late 60s played, and there are games from 2009 that maybe kids born in the 90s and beyond played, and maybe you've played all of them. And we're going to talk about them with a particular focus on the Nintendo Entertainment System version, obviously. But we're going to go through all of them.
Are we going to go through the rules and regulations of the World Video Boxing Association
We're going to have to at some point, yes. Now, boxing, the sport, we're not doing what is boxing, don't worry. But Quinn, what is punching?
What is punching? It's where you make a fist.
Right.
And you kind of fling it. What would be the action? You thrust it.
Thrust it.
You thrust it at someone's face and it hurts them. Might knock them out, even.
You might punch them out.
Yeah.
Obviously, you guys know what punching is. You know what boxing is. But boxing video games, Quinn, it's interesting. They were around before Punch-Out.
This is true.
They're still around. Sega's Heavyweight Champion, if you're curious, was the first ever boxing video game, 1976, in the arcade.
Perhaps owing its inspiration to the hit movie Rocky, one of the machines lets 98-pound weaklings play Heavyweight Champion.
Very primitive, and there have been a ton of them over the years. Some of my favorites are like Evander Holyfield for Genesis. There was Foreman, KO Boxing, and Foreman for Real on Super Nintendo.
There's also that weird one on Atari back in the
day.
There
is Atari Boxing.
It's like the characters look weird.
Well, that's every Atari game.
Yeah.
But I know the one you mean where they're like Jell-O or something.
They're very stringy.
They look like lamps. I'm not really sure. And there's been franchises like the Fight Night series, the Rocky series.
Yeah,
like
they just made Rocky.
Yeah, why the hell not? Knockout Kings. A lot of successful ones. A lot of realistic ones. But I would say that none have captured the imagination quite like the unrealistic but hyper-addictive and challenging Punch-Out series,
yes,
Quinn.
Punch-Out with exclamation points. Don't forget.
Well, it's very serious. It's very,
very exciting.
It is very exciting.
11 world-class contenders. Take them down with your controller, beat them all, and you've got a shot at Tyson's title.
I love the series in general. I would say my favorite is, to this day, still Mike Tyson's Punch-Out for Nintendo.
Yeah, I think so.
And I also really liked Super Punch-Out. Now, that could be generationally because of when we were born, which is the mid-80s. Those are the two that we had the most access to. But we might have some folks listening that love the arcade one more than anything.
Or some people might like the Wii one.
Exactly. So we want to hear from you. Do that on Twitter or, of course, on our Facebook group. Let us know your memories of Punch-Out, your favorite Punch-Out game. But let's get into it here. Why did this capture the imagination? How did this all start? Because there were boxing games before.
Mm-hmm.
There have been after. Why was Punch-Out one of the most successful and most memorable?
Nintendo. That's why.
100%. Now, we've already done a pretty good history of Nintendo in our 16-bit Wars episode, which you can find where, Quinn?
In the archives.
But just to really sum it up here, Nintendo was started as a playing card company in the late 19th century.
And then they became game wizards.
They eventually did toys and became game wizards, in the 70s.
Game Morlocks. I don't know what to do. These guys know how to make a damn video game. They still do.
They still do. And their first killer app, if you will, was Donkey Kong 1981. Right. That was a huge smash arcade hit. And it was followed up with 1983's Mario Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Not to be confused with Super Mario Brothers. This is the single screen game where you play as Mario and or Luigi.
The precursor.
That was especially big in the United States. So that brought Nintendo to the forefront as far as arcade game developers were concerned. And in 1983, Nintendo previously had overbought Quinn. They had overpurchased a large stock of arcade monitors.
Yes.
Based on sales projections for Donkey Kong and Mario Brothers.
Yes, if I recall, it's some weird like space game or something that was like from the 70s that was like part of all of the technology that they were like, make a game for this because we bought too many, right?
We bought too many. And if anyone knows anything about, you know, business economics, unsold inventory just sitting on your floor is making you $0, usually losing you money.
It's funny that this is kind of the genesis, if you will,
of
Punch-Out, right? To me, it speaks to just how Nintendo is. They'd always work with what they had, you know, or whatever the situation may be, right?
Sure.
I mean, they were never about pushing overpowered hardware or anything, right?
They really weren't.
It's always very economical. I mean, when you look back to the Game Boy, for example, I mean, that they could have made something better than that, but they were like, well, we want it to last like 12 hours or some crazy crap, right? So we've really got to dumb this thing down, right?
Absolutely, and it's the same case here. They were actually also experimenting with certain microchips that allowed for zooming on the sprites in the midst of all of this.
Scaling,
exactly, yeah. Quinn. And the initial idea after the space game was, well, why don't we make a dual screen, a side-by-side, a racing game with huge sprites since we have these chips and we have the monitors.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're like, you know what? This is not going to happen.
F that.
Not going to work.
Nintendo would later make a racing game that was popular in Japan, I believe F1, Nintendo F1 Racing or something like that. Yeah, where Mario's like in a very cute racing outfit, you know?
Cute Mario.
Yeah. Like, look, I can fix the car. Let's go.
But this whole let's make the sprites big thing, let's use the two monitors, it didn't die out with this racing idea. Someone came up with the idea of, well, what if you make a boxing game with very large boxers? And why don't you use one screen for the actual boxing action, and then your top screen would have stats like the tail of the tape, it would have maybe the card of who's fighting, banners, things like that. And thus the idea for Punch-Out was born.
I find it this whole thing interesting too, because this speaks again to Nintendo has a weird thing about having two screens, no? I mean, even during this time, like Game & Watch.
Game & Watch.
You know, like that kind of thing. And then eventually the DS, and they brought it to the consoles at one point with the Wii U. I mean, this company has a history with two-screen video games.
That's
right?
An interesting point.
They really like this concept over there.
I guess so. I mean, the impetus here was we had too many monitors, which is really funny. There are two people that we need to talk about that were involved in the development of this game. One of them was Genyo Takeda, who had joined Nintendo in 1972. He worked in their R&D2 department, research and development, and then moved over to R&D3, which at the time was the smallest of the R&Ds. Later, this gentleman, much, much later, was one of the lead developers for the Nintendo Wii. So he would go on to be a major player.
Yeah, that speaks to the kind of company Nintendo is. I mean, I heard it recently. The new Legend of Zelda came out as a press time, and somebody on Twitter, they made a comment. It was from somewhere, and it actually kind of makes sense. It's like, you know why Nintendo still makes good games? Because nobody leaves.
That's a great point.
It's still all the people who made the Zelda now, they're still the ones who, some of them worked on the first one.
Absolutely,
Quinn. You know, and that speaks to why they're just very good at this kind of thing, right?
Yeah.
A lot of experience,
exactly. Yeah. The other person, speaking of people that never leave, speaking of people that would go on to have a ton of experience, the other person involved with developing Punch-Out was Shigeru Miyamoto.
Of course. Who he had his fingers and everything.
He had joined Nintendo pretty recently in 77 at this point.
Yeah, he was the newbie.
He was actually pretty new.
Yeah, he was the newbie in town.
He was. He was involved with the character design of Punch-Out. And obviously, if you don't know this, I guess we should say it, he would go on. He had done Donkey Kong.
Right.
And Mario Brothers. He would go on and do Super Mario Brothers, pretty much almost anything Mario related. And of course, Legend of Zelda?
That was him, right? Game,
that guy?
Yeah.
So, still very famous name as far as Nintendo is concerned. Also, a third party here. This was the first Nintendo project for the musical director and composer, Koji Kondo.
Koji Kondo, yeah.
Who would go on, of course, to do the music for the Mario Brothers franchise. Mm-hmm. And I believe Legend of Zelda.
Yes.
Yeah, again, people that don't leave.
Don't leave this place.
Right, exactly.
Although I think Koji Kondo did to like do his own independent music career.
And good for him.
Yeah.
He wrote some catchy tunes. So anyway, this game was developed here, and in February of 1984, for those of you that like the dates, Punch-Out was released to arcades in Japan, and 1 month later in March of 1984 in the United States of America.
Body blow, knock him out.
I'll say this, you know, it's funny you say how quickly it came to America.
Yeah.
This from a perspective of like marketing and stuff, this has universal appeal, this concept of doing a sport, no?
I would definitely say
and
so.
And I think that gives it a little bit of an advantage for appealing to bigger crowds.
Yeah, I think so. It's really hard not to relate to just wanting to punch some guy that's annoying.
Right. On top of it, it's an actual sport.
And it's a real sport, too.
Right. So I think the concept itself as a whole is a winner, you know?
Yeah, because it's not high concept. You don't have to get into fantasy themes and things like that.
No, if you've seen people punch each other in a movie, television show, in real life,
a bar,
then you know what this is.
Right. You know what this is. You have some basic rudimentary grasp of what boxing is.
Right.
And what's great about Nintendo, which will become a recurring theme, they're not going for realism here in 1983. You know, they're not going for realism now. That's a good point. They're not going
because it's all the same people.
It all circles back.
Yeah.
No, they're not going for that. They're going for a fun experience and most importantly, a game that people are going to want to pump quarters into.
Right, exactly.
Continually. I mean, that's the goal, right? Mm-hmm. More than an artistic achievement, the goal is you want people to keep playing the game.
Yes.
Let's be honest here. So the original Punch-Out, for those of you maybe that have never played it, look this up if you never have. Look into it, you know?
I've only played it like twice myself in like retro arcades that like had machines like it was practically a museum.
Well, okay, you know? Fair enough. I have played it both in the actual arcade and also on emulation. So mm-hmm. I've played it my fair share. You control a green-haired, and that's due to sprite, you know, color limitations, a green-haired, wire-framed journeyman boxer who sometimes Nintendo retcons into being Little Mac, but that's not his name in the game,
for the record. Does he even have a name?
Because you put your initials in.
Right, yeah.
He's not named.
So let's talk 1 second about this. Okay, so we're starting at Mac or whoever he is,
Fake Mac.
Wire Mac.
Yeah, Wire Mac.
This wireframe thing, right?
Yes.
To me, this is one of the big standouts right from the jump, because that in 1984 looks interesting and like high tech or something, right?
It does, and it serves the function of being able to see the entire boxer through the opponent.
It's an actually like novel concept. I know some games played with wireframes in the mid-80s like that. Nintendo wasn't the first or anything, but it is very cool.
I think it's great.
I think it just lends to the video boxing nature of it, too.
I think so, and I think if he was solid, it wouldn't work as well in 1984.
No, not at all.
I just don't think it would. So you're playing him, and he's a journeyman boxer, and your basic moves are you punch.
Right.
Because it's boxing.
Punch.
You don't kick.
Right.
It's not kickboxing.
Yeah, no shit.
You can do two types of punches.
Right.
You could do body blow, as the sprite says, or you could do a punch to the face. You can dodge from side to side, and there's a block, and you can block, but you can't duck in the first punch out. And there's a KO meter that fills up as you land punches and as you don't get hit. And once that meter fills up, you hit another button on the arcade board, and you can do like a super uppercut punch.
Yes.
Knockout punch, so to speak, right? And the way this works, now we know typical boxing, it has rounds that are 3 minutes, real boxing, I'm saying. Right. That's not really going to be realistic for this type of gameplay, so they have 1 3-minute round, just one.
Yeah.
And you have to win. If you don't win, that's it. You'll lose, right?
Get off the machine,
Get off the machine.
We have more customers here.
Exactly. Now, your opponents, and we're going to talk about the boxers introduced, to put it bluntly, they are stereotypes, they are caricatures of many different things.
And they would be throughout the series.
They still were as of 2009, right?
Yeah.
The most recent game that was made. But they, see, in my opinion, Quinn, not only was the concept a good one, you know, cartoonish boxing, great, it really, because you know you can't make it realistic, so fuck it. Let's not even try to make this realistic.
Yeah, but, and also you see Miyamoto here, the art design is excellent.
It's like, it's incredible.
He picked a theme of this kind of caricature boxer thing, and like I think they all the characters fit it, and it just, it makes the game seem more dynamic and more interesting and appealing. You know, just from a, like a visual, because a lot of these arcade games, they were trying to, I mean, you have to remember, these machines were just in a corner somewhere, and they were trying to attract your attention as you walked by.
Yeah.
Right? And these designs are beautiful, honestly.
They really are, and they were very, very large characters. I don't want to overstate that. You know what I mean?
And that was a big deal, believe it or not, if you weren't around back then. Big sprites was like a technical achievement. Like,
exactly.
People were like, this is crazy.
Yeah, plus it had the other monitor showing a static image of other things. So, I mean, it was really cool. So we're going to meet the opponents here, and the opponents, to me, are another reason, in my opinion, why Punch-Out is so memorable.
Mm-hmm.
Because every opponent, for the most part, is very different, has different attacks, different quirks, different patterns to figure out.
Yes.
And they're all of varying difficulty for different people.
This is true.
Which is very fun. So what I'd like to do, Quinn, is run through them here, and then when we get to the NES version, we can spend some time on the ones that also appear in the NES version.
Carried over, right?
Correct. So, you know what? I also want to mention here, the music, the theme, was actually the Gillette Cavalcade of Sports Boxing theme.
Excuse me?
Yeah, and some people don't know. This is from the 1950s. Let's take a listen to this. It'll probably sound familiar to you.
Oh, yeah. Huh. That's funny.
Isn't that... So now you know. We don't want to upset Andrew Rogers, Quinn. All right, so the first opponent, a Nintendo icon.
Yes, an icon for being a loser.
A big loser, 1-99, always his record, from Paris, France. Of course, we're talking about the training character, Glass Joe.
There he is, Glass Joe.
Glass Joe. And again, we'll have more on him in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out.
Right.
Glass Joe!
But the eternal loser, you know what I mean?
What a loser.
And obviously the idea here is to give the player confidence that, hey, I can figure this game out. I can play this game.
He basically isn't even like a pattern or anything. Yeah. Like, he's just garbage.
He's just a punching bag.
Yeah.
After him is Piston Hurricane from Cuba.
Piston Hurricane!
And he's a little bit better.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Slightly.
Then we have another icon.
Bald Bull.
Bald Bull from Istanbul.
So Bald
Bull. Not Constantinople.
If I recall, he's like, he's one of the first, like, okay, this guy is like, he's a tough customer. And he's got a trick to him. And I wanted to wait till the NES to say this, but I think you kind of have to, even at the beginning. So Punch-Out is a weird game, because it's not a traditional boxing game in the sense of, like, sport and stuff like that.
Right.
It is a puzzle game.
It is.
With a boxing, like face paint, like a face mask over it, you know?
It's a memory game.
Yeah.
It's kind of a cognitive test.
Yeah.
It is. I mean, it's an involved game. It really uses your mental prowess.
The core of it, every single opponent is a puzzle to be solved. It's not really like a test of like speed or anything like that.
Or skill or luck.
Yeah, you have to think your way out of it. And I think that's what makes this series so unique, and that's what its hook is.
Yeah.
You don't have to be the fastest draw. No. Like, you know, you have to figure out the timings and like figure out like, okay, he does this, then he does that. Okay, there's the opening.
Right.
And then you have to remember it because they'll keep doing it over and over again, right?
It's a memory test. It's a lot of different functions
in your brain. Some of the characters, as it gets more complicated, they'll have one or two different patterns to kind of mess with your head, right?
Yes.
Because then you're like, okay, he does this one first, but then he does this one, and then sometimes there's a third, and you're like, I got to remember, okay, I got to switch up. And some of them are completely drastically different within the fight. Like, you have to completely change everything that you're doing.
I think that's very well said, Quinn. Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up here. So Bald Bull, again, more on him later, but another feared opponent of the Punch-Out franchise.
And he, to me, always represented one of the key, like, puzzle ones, because he does have a distinct thing he does that you have to, like, know how to react to.
100%, Quinn. Then comes Kid Quick from Brooklyn.
Kid Quick!
His whole thing is that he's very skinny, but very, very quick.
Yes.
Okay? Then we have, I can't believe this is the guy's name. So, we have some stereotypes here, particularly Glass Joe and,
it's Punch-Out.
And Bold Bull from Turkey, stern Turkish, but this guy, who never appeared again, thankfully, from Naples, Italy, Pizza Pasta.
Pizza Pasta!
Pizza Pasta, yeah, that's definitely people's names from Italy. Yeah.
I cannot, and I'm not offended, as a 100% Italian-American, I don't give a shit. I cannot believe...
You almost can't help but laugh because it's just so stupid.
The laziness in naming him that. Yeah. You know, it's not even a name!
Yeah, it's just food.
Right? Like Piston, Hurricane, Bald Bull. These are names. Kid, Quick.
It's almost like, because it was made by Japanese people, it was almost like none of them knew Italian names.
Right.
But they knew the food, right?
They just looked at a menu.
They looked at a menu and like, as a work. I wonder what it sounds like phonetically to a Japanese person when you don't know English.
Maybe it sounds badass or something.
Yeah,
right?
Maybe it sounds like good or something, right? It's like, that's what I'm wondering.
Oh, Pizza Pasta, that's a good one.
That sounds like a badass, right?
Holy shit, if they're looking at the right menu, we could have had veal scallopini over here. Yeah. You know, it could have been chicken parm.
Mm-hmm.
Pizza Pasta is a stereotypical, like, 50-year-old with, like, a widow's peak balding head Italian boxer, and he never appeared again. Now, the next guy is not a stereotype. The final boss of Punch-Out is not a stereotype. He is a straight up, like, he is played straight, besides his name is gimmicky. Other than that, he is played straight as, like, a serious contender, the champion, Mr. Sandman.
The champion of the world, Mr. Sandman!
Yeah, Mr. Sandman, like, he is, like, the prototypical, like, champion boxer.
Heavyweight boxer.
Like Joe Frazier or something.
I believe they say, it's never been confirmed by Nintendo, but the inference is that because they're both from Philadelphia and Joe Frazier was popular not too long before this, like the 70s, that he might be based on Joe Frazier.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you win, it just loops. Like, there's no, like, it doesn't go on after that.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you beat Mr. Sandman, which is friggin' hard to do in the arcade one. It really is.
Yeah, I mean, and you're all doing this on a quarter.
Yeah, exactly. It just keeps looping around. I think it might get faster or harder or something like that, but nothing else changes.
That's called, we need to get them off the machine.
Yeah.
And just keep making it harder.
And that's pretty standard fare for 80s arcade machines anyway. There's no ending.
They all do that, like Gradius, for example, like people who were so good at the game.
Yeah.
It became a game for them to see how many loops they could.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah.
Exactly. Right. So was this game successful? It was actually the top performing United States arcade game of 1984.
Really? Of the whole year, eh?
Of the whole year, eh?
That's interesting.
Very popular.
Because you don't hear it talked about in that respect. Like, it's weirdly forgotten because of the NES version later.
I think that has a lot to do with it.
Yeah.
I do, because you're right. If you're born of our generation, folks, and some of our fans are around our age or a little younger or even more younger, you might not know how popular Punch-Out the arcade game was.
But it's kind of fascinating, though, to think that just casually the most top-selling game of the entire year. Like, right? Just, there it is. Punch-Out.
Yeah. And again, for a lot of the reasons that we mentioned, the memorability, the attractability.
Especially in that golden era, which means it was making gobs of money, because that is like prime arcade era.
Absolutely is. Yeah, the golden age of arcade gaming, right? So naturally, they released a sequel, and the brilliant thing here is because they already had the framework, they already had the engine, they already had all this. What do you do when the whole goal is just to fight colorful opponents?
Make more colorful opponents to fight.
Make more colorful opponents to fight. So in September of 84, that's it.
Wow.
Only months
later. I mean, the turnover on these. This is not like now where they take like 6 years to make a video game. Like, they were just like, hey, that did good. We need to get another one. Now. Like, right now.
And that's exactly what it was. September of 84 in Japan and October in the United States. So 7 months between releases here. we are introduced to Super Punch-Out, not to be confused with the later title for Super Nintendo.
Now this is in essence, though, like kind of an expansion pack of some of sorts, right?
Today,
in arcade terms.
Today it would be DLC.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Or an expansion
pack. It's just
pack.
More guys. It's like the same game.
It's new opponents, same game. The only thing that changed is that the difficulty was said to have increased.
Okay.
And, which makes sense because people are familiar with the first game already.
Yep.
And they added ducking as a way to evade punches.
Yes.
So you can finally not only block and dodge, but you can duck. So Super Punch-Out featured only five characters. You're still playing as the unnamed Green Man.
Mm-hmm.
The first opponent here is Bear Hugger from
Bear Hugger,
Salmon Arm, British Columbia.
That's our place.
It is.
Wait, it is?
It is.
Salmon Arm?
Salmon Arm, British Columbia.
We make videos about what it's truly like to live, work, and play here right in Salmon Arm.
Boy, oh boy. You learn something new every day. I didn't think that was real.
If anyone out there has ever been to Salmon Arm, please send us pictures. Bear Hugger is a stereotypical big, fat, bearded, jolly, maple syrup swigging Canadian.
Logger man.
Yeah, like, just like a logger. Yeah,
yeah,
exactly.
He's got like overalls on and stuff.
No shirt.
Yeah.
A woodsman, big beard.
Canadian Bear Hugger.
A very easy opponent, obviously, yes. In Super Punch-Out. Now, after that, you have to fight from Hong Kong. Dragon Chan.
Dragon Chan.
This guy was cool, dude.
No, he is cool.
This is actually like Dragon Chan's one of the more unique opponents that I remember.
Well, he fucking cheats. He kicks.
He can kick you. Yeah,
it's not fair.
I feel like that's a huge like that turns your that you're like what the like. I remember first fighting him in Super Nintendo and being like what the like.
Who
I don't
is
even
this
like.
Guy?
Is this even allowed?
Right.
Like,
it shouldn't be. Yeah. But again, we're not going
it's
for the
just
realism.
Bruce Lee too. Right. Like
yes, it's clearly Bruce Lee.
Yeah,
Dragon Chan, and then. If you make it past the kicking man, Dragon Chan, you have to face Vodka Drunkinsky.
Vodka Drunkinsky.
Vodka Drunkinsky.
From
very,
Moscow.
Very real name.
Almost as bad as Pizza Pasta.
Yeah. He's definitely the Pizza Pasta of this crew, right?
Yes, the Russian Pizza
what is,
Pasta.
It's just like a tradition now. Like,
yeah, we just need someone
we
like
need
this.
Somebody food-based. Food or drink.
Now, obviously, that's a Russian stereotype, and the United States, I don't know if you know this, was not in very friendly terms with Russia in 1984.
Were they?
They weren't, as far as I understand. No,
Mr. Gorbachev.
Yeah, tear down this wall. Anyway, he can be difficult. He can be a pain in the ass.
Yeah.
Then after that, Great Tiger from Mumbai, which was Bombay at the time.
Yes.
Great Tiger!
From India, and thus has a turban on with a jewel that glows.
But he has a cool gimmick. The jewel will glow is the tell, right? And like
and
that's what
point.
I thought he was such a cool opponent.
Everyone has a tell. That's a great point. Some of them are like dopey, like Bear Hugger just like, like waves
some
at you
Some of them are
shit.
Hard to notice. That's why, like, to me as a kid, I liked fighting Great Tiger because I got it.
Sure.
Right. It was understandable what the tell was.
Right. It's true. It's true. And he did a teleport punch, and it was a big pain in the ass sometimes.
Yeah, that thing keeps coming at you till you block it.
I know.
Like, terrible.
And Great Tiger from India. And then the final boss of Super Punch-Out for the arcade is none other than from Hollywood, California, the bodybuilder Super Macho Man.
Super Macho Man.
Super Macho Man. And now this is before Macho Man Randy Savage was in WF, like, and famous and stuff,
this
right?
This is correct. So you know who he was a pastiche of?
Superstar Billy Graham.
You got it.
Yep.
Yep. And 100% right. With down to the hairline.
I mean, he looks exactly like him.
Yep. Right? He is a pastiche of Superstar Billy Graham.
I think that's kind of funny and cool also at the same time that a wrestler man is the boxing like champion.
Fuck it. Yeah. Right? I mean, why the hell not?
Yeah.
And he is a hard opponent in any iteration.
Goodness. Yeah, he's so fast.
With the spinning punches and stuff, and sometimes he only does it once, and sometimes he keeps doing it.
You know the funny thing in Punch-Out, when you say fast, it's fast, but all it means is that you have to duck earlier.
Yeah, it's
right?
sudden.
It means that you have to, there's like a tell before the tell. And that's the trick.
Where
right?
you have like a fraction of a second to make your decision.
But he looks like he's going to do something.
Yeah, it's frustrating.
So you know.
This game is hard.
Yeah. I just always thought that was cool how the timing adjusts to a certain point where it's like, no, it's like, it's not a tell like the other guys where it's like right before. It's right before that, right before.
The
right?
tell before the tell.
The
right?
tell before the tell, yes. Yeah, exactly. So just such a cool idea.
I think so. Yeah. And Super Punch-Out was a cool idea. It also did very well in the arcades. And now we have an unlicensed clone alert, Quinn.
And what is this?
For the Commodore 64.
Oh, no.
The ZX
That's
Spectrum.
That's not Nintendo.
The ZX Spectrum. And the Amstrad CPC in 1985, the world was treated to Frank Bruno's boxing. Ooh. Now, Frank Bruno, some of our boxing aficionados like Tony Leg Day.
Oh, he's going to be mad that I didn't know who that is.
That's fine. He was a British boxer, but he hadn't yet been world champion by 1985. He was just, a notable enough boxer. But anyway, this was an unlicensed port to this hardware, and it was, suffice to say...
It looks exactly like the game.
Yeah, just lower quality.
If I know Nintendo,
do you know Nintendo?
There's no way that this thing didn't get sued into oblivion even back then.
I don't know if it was sued. I don't know how this all worked.
Maybe Nintendo just was like, you better fucking not make another one of these.
It might have been
like one of those.
It might have been unlicensed, but they still had permission to do it.
I mean, the characters are even the same.
Exactly. Now, this game was actually, believe it or not, Quinn, very successful.
Of course it was. It's like essentially a port of Punch-Out.
Yeah.
And the word probably got out because, I mean, it's the best game of 1984 or whatever. Right.
So I just need to run down. There's the three, they imported three Punch-Out characters.
Okay.
Bear Hugger became Canadian Crusher.
Okay.
It's actually not a bad name.
It's not bad at all.
Dragon Chan became Fling Long Chop.
What?
And Vodka Drunkinsky became Andra Punch-A-Dreadoff.
Okay.
And then there are original characters in the game, such as Tribal Trouble, I don't want to know.
Nope.
Frenchy France.
that's just so generic. Frenchy France. Frenchy, like, that's very uncreative. He's from France.
Raviola Mafiosi.
Oh, goodness. Come on. There's no wonder nobody heard of this, right? Like, or remembered it.
Antipodian and Andy.
Antipodian.
And Peter Perfect.
What is that, the champion?
I guess so.
Peter Perfect.
I'm still caught up on Raviola Mafiosi, honestly. Yeah. But anyway, this game was successful.
I think Frenchy France was definitely the best
pretty
one.
Good. It was big in the UK. Sixth best-selling game in Great Britain.
It's on ZX Spectrum, yeah. So you know, like, that weird computer they had.
Thanks a lot, England.
Yeah.
But guess what? We have a licensed sequel alert.
Licensed.
And this game is known as Nintendo's Arm Wrestling.
Why?
What the hell is this? So
what does this have to do with punching?
Well, it doesn't. It's you use the arm,
okay,
you know, and your fist, similar to punching. Nintendo was like, how can we capitalize on this using the same graphics engine?
Yeah, it's just that we need to use the same machine.
Same dual screen.
We're not getting a new one for this anymore.
And that's what it was. It came out in May of 1985. Mm-hmm. Those of you overseas that maybe didn't play it, it's because it didn't come out overseas. It only came out in North America. It was the same basic concept. Instead of punching, you're trying to win arm wrestling, right? Mm-hmm. Which is not as popular of a sport as boxing, clearly, and doesn't have as widespread appeal.
Until that famous Sylvester Stallone movie, Over the Top, obviously it popularized the sport.
That's a very good point.
Mr. Cutler is talking to you.
I'm through talking.
So there is one Punch-Out carryover here. A character by the name of Mask X. When he
looks familiar. Maybe he might be...
He is revealed to be Bald Bull.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yes.
I didn't want to spoil it.
No. We'll
if anybody if you don't listen, well, it's too late now. They listened. They're going to find out about this 30-something-year-old game.
Just turn it off now, folks. Yeah. We're sorry about that, okay? This game did not fare that well. Big surprise.
You think?
However,
I didn't even know it existed until you told me about it. I play a lot of video games. What the hell?
That's true, Quinn. Nintendo still wanted to bring the success of the arcade Punch-Outs to the Nintendo Entertainment System, and this is where we pick up the story of a man named Mike Tyson.
Hey, Diet Pepsi's a champion too.
Now, Mike Tyson...
Who's that?
One of the most famous boxers to live,
right,
especially of his generation. Born proudly in Catskill, New York,
right,
for the record.
There.
He had a very good amateur career, and he turned pro in March of 1985 at the age of 18.
Right, young kid,
got
right involved in the sport, and he kicked a bunch of ass.
He fought 15 times his first year, and he won all 15, most by knockout. Gradually faced better competition, as you would when you do that. First televised fight was about a year into his career, February of 86. rose up the ranks and faced the, at the time, WBC champion, Trevor Burbick, in November of 1986.
Yes.
Okay? So he's been pro since March of 85. It's now November of 86. He's got a heavyweight championship bout against Trevor Burbick, the man who defeated Muhammad Ali in his last fight. And Mike Tyson won this championship in the first round.
We've got a brand new heavyweight champion of the world, Mike Tyson.
He became the youngest boxing champion ever at the age of 20 years old and 4 months. It's pretty crazy.
Wow, crazy.
And then he became the WBA champion by defeating James Bone Crusher Smith in March of 87.
For the new WBA-WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson.
He's got two belts now. And fuck it, let's add another one. In August of 1987, he defeated the IBF champion, Tony Tucker.
An undisputed heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson.
We're forgetting about the most prestigious title he won, Joe.
What's that?
The WVBA championship.
Exactly. And how did that come about? Well, the Nintendo of America president, Minoru Arakawa, he happened to see a Mike Tyson fight in person.
Right.
And he was insanely impressed by this guy. And he told the developers of Punch-Out as they were working to get this thing on the NES somehow, right? He said, why don't you put him in the game?
Right.
Okay? So, Genyo Takeda, from the original, he was assigned as the director of this conversion, or rebuild, really, of Punch-Out to the NES. And Quinn, anyone that's played both, whether you've played the arcade, whether you played Super and played Mike Tyson's, a vastly different game, though the same concept.
Same concept. It feels, I think on the controller, right? It has a feel to it, right? It feels like you're...
A fluidity, maybe.
It has a fluidity and a rhythm, right? It definitely has a rhythm.
Oh, it has a rhythm.
This game is, like, to me, the perfect, like, incarnation of the Punch-Out concept. It's heavy on the puzzle, but it does, once you get to the higher rounds, give you a bunch of challenge to, you know, reaction and stuff like that. So it's got a nice little balance there.
Yep.
And the opponent lineup is kind of like a best of the best from, like, Super and regular.
Yep, and
right?
You get a couple of new faces as well, which is kind of cool. And also, I guess worth mentioning is, due to the limitations of the actual Nintendo hardware and what it could do, they came up with an idea to compensate because they couldn't do the wireframe thing.
Right.
So they said, well, why don't we just make the main character a really small guy?
It's small,
an
but...
An underdog.
And you're kind of behind the back, but also over the head, weirdly.
Yeah.
It's like a strange angle. It's almost like... Like the camera's above him, but pointing over his shoulder.
Yeah, the camera's like in the second tier of the stands.
Yeah, it's
or
like
something.
A weird angle, but it gives you the perfect, because you can see the punch, and you can see going side to side. And the best part is it's high enough so you can see him going back too.
Exactly.
Right? It's like, so you kind of have a full degree of motion.
Yeah.
With little Mac.
So they got around these limitations.
Yeah.
And the opponents, by the way, are still very large sprites and very impressive looking.
Right. And that's the other thing for NES.
Yep.
Well, not as big as the arcade. Of course, it couldn't be that big. They're pretty damn big.
They are.
Like, for NES.
They are, and that gives it that colorfulness and that memorability that people remember.
Oh, like, very iconic for the NES, too, because you got to remember, the audience is much bigger, because the NES is selling like hotcakes by 87.
This is 87 that we're talking
about. Everyone has this damn thing.
It was the most popular thing.
And people were looking for things to play on it.
Right.
You know?
And they weren't going to pass up an opportunity to bring their most successful arcade game of 1984 to the home market.
Just like they did with Donkey Kong and Mario Brothers.
Yeah. And not only in Japan, but obviously in North America as well. So, Japan, this is an interesting note here that maybe is not common knowledge, and if it is, I apologize. Japan released this first in September of 87, but it was known as the gold version. It was a special edition, a limited edition, and it did not have Mike Tyson in it.
Yeah, so that's the other aspect to this game, I guess, right off the bat, the variants of
it,
right? Is like, okay, so there's this non-Mike Tyson Japanese initial version, right?
Where he's just not in it at all.
Now, who's the boss there?
Super Macho Man.
Okay.
Is the last guy.
So Super Macho, so the boss of Super Punch-Out is just the boss.
He's just the boss. But only 1 month later in North America, Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, as it was renamed, was released in the United States. So obviously Nintendo struck a licensing deal with Mike Tyson, who, remember, in October of 87, he's got three championships.
He's reigning champion. Pretty much the undisputed champion.
And in Japan in November, 1 month later, they release Mike Tyson's Punch-Out. So this gold thing was...
And that's just, you know, just on an aside about video games during this time and all the way up to the late 90s, Japan got everything. Like, they, if there was an American difference version, they'd also get that, and they call it, like, international
version. Yeah, they did it late.
Like, you'd get every version there because it was the home country of the console maker, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And so, like, I just think that's cool that they had a pre-release version.
They did.
Right? And then they had the Mike Tyson version, and then later they'd get the other version,
they got
too.
Yep, exactly. So... Punch-Out comes out in the fall of 1987. Nintendo is very popular. Mike Tyson is very popular. Let's find out how this game fared on the other side of this break when more Acid Wash Memories returns right after this.
Don't call it a comeback.
You think you know a lot about oatmeal? Well, this is going to surprise you. You know how other cereals have that long list of ingredients? Quaker Oats has no long list. It has a list of one ingredient, 100% rolled oats, the whole grain, all natural, nothing added, nothing taken out. Now, that's about as natural as food is likely to get. Quaker Oats, it's the right thing to do.
Wednesday.
Balky?
Balky takes a course at Kung Fu U. It's Perfect Strangers. Then, the kids make a smash hit with their version of Grease. Head of the class right after Perfect Strangers. Tomorrow.
Now for just $10.99 at Kentucky Fried Chicken, you get 10 pieces of delicious fried chicken.
What? No mashed potatoes?
And a large order of mashed potatoes and a large gravy.
Oh, what about biscuits?
And 4 hot buttermilk biscuits.
You know, a salad would be nice.
And a large order of coleslaw.
All right, close enough.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
The $10.99 family meal, just $10.99 at Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Could you throw in
any... You're pushing it.
Oh.
Hurry in now. Offer in soon.
You think you know a lot about oatmeal?
I don't know!
And now we return to more Acid Washed Memories.
Hey, welcome back to Acid Washed Memories, episode 20, Retro Pop Culture Celebration, of course. We're talking about Punch-Out. I'm Joe Morata, knocking it out with Michael Quinn. How you doing there, Michael?
Mama said knock you out.
Yeah, well, she did. Yeah.
That was the theme of Punch-Out,
that
right?
That was the theme, yes. And folks, as we've mentioned, the theme of our show is Retro Pop Culture Celebration, so why don't you celebrate with us on Twitter at AWM Podcast and join our Facebook group. And if you regret it, just unjoin it. It's fine.
Just get out of it if you don't like it.
It's really okay. And if you wouldn't mind, leave us a review on your favorite podcast application. But Quinn, when we left off here before the break, it was the fall of 87.
Mm-hmm.
Mike Tyson's on top of the world, and so is the Nintendo Entertainment System,
yep,
or the Famicom in Japan. And this game, Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, is released. So let's just run it down. This is the most popular one that ever came out. Most people probably remember this. Let's run down the characters and our experiences here. We have to start with the protagonist, the aptly named Little Mac.
Little Mac.
From Brooklyn,
and his Bronx. And his trainer, Big Mac.
No. That's not his name. It is Doc Lewis.
That's what I called him in my headcanon.
Now, that's a Mandela thing. A lot of people call him Big Mac, right?
Because you got Little Mac. Who's Big Mac? There he is. He's with him.
So the story
his
here,
uncle or whoever.
It's not his uncle.
Well, I heard people say that, too.
It's never said.
Yeah.
Little Mac is an aspiring boxer. He's 17. He's a kid, right? And he's from the Bronx. And Doc Lewis is a former boxing champion that has agreed, mm-hmm, down on his luck, agreed to train him.
So he's Mick from Rocky, basically.
I like him more than Mick.
What?
Yeah, I like Doc Lewis more than Mick.
They're both so lovable. I like both of them.
I guess so. I guess they're both lovable. I mean, yeah. Send your cards and letters to me if you're mad at me for that one. But anyway, Little Mac is just beginning in his World Video Game Boxing Association.
Oh,
here.
Yeah.
You know, he's got to learn the ropes.
A very prestigious organization.
Definitely
he wants
is.
To get involved in that.
And much like the controls of the original game, he can punch to the head, he can punch to the torso, he can block, dodge, and cover his head when the opponents punch him. But rather than the KO meter, there is this there's two little counters up at the top of the screen. There is the heart, which is how much energy he has left.
Mm-hmm.
And there is, if you happen to hit your opponent at the right time, you get a star.
Right.
And you can store up to 3 stars at any time. And when you press the start button and you do your big super punch. Okay. So this time it's a little bit different. Rather than 1 3-minute round, we have 3 rounds. And they're around, I mean, they're roughly like a minute and change. The counter goes down really fast.
Yes.
It's not really 3 minutes.
It's like bullshit time.
It's bullshit time.
It's always like, you ever notice when you're losing, but you're like, you're coming back, and then suddenly like the clock on that game is just like, well, fuck you.
Fucking
and it just
annoying.
Starts going, it's like 2 seconds go down in one. You're like, what the hell?
I know, it's true. So we got 3 rounds. There's the 3-knockdown rule, which is normal for boxing. You know, if you knock your opponent down 3 times, you win. If you get knocked down 3 times, you lose, right? There's no way around that.
From game terms, it always felt like you had like 3 lives to beat the guy, right?
Yep.
But he also had 3 lives.
He also has 3 lives. So it's fair in that regard.
Yeah.
If no one gets knocked out, and it goes to the end of the 3 rounds, there's a decision. And that's based on the number of points you've accumulated. You get points by punching.
Right.
And that varies and increases per opponent. So
now, I always felt they get real stingy with the fucking points.
Oh,
near the
they
end.
Do!
Like, we're like, you're just like, you could kick the shit out of him, but it's just taking you too long to beat him. And
yep.
It's just like, you lose.
Yeah.
Like, he didn't even do dick, but you'll never get the decision.
I forget who it is, if it's like Bald Bull where you need like 10,000 points, but if
it's
you're
like, get the fuck out of here.
If you're at like 9,990, you're fucked.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You were winning the whole time, but you just didn't do it fast enough.
Yeah.
Why don't you just say that?
Yeah.
It's like, I have to win by KO or TKO, and he doesn't.
It's hard to win, like, by decision.
Yeah.
Also, the referee of Mike Tyson's Punch-Out is a very weirdly drawn Mario.
Yeah, so Mario with a cameo here. I love that, by the way.
That's good.
That's such a good like little touch,
it's
right?
It's very Nintendo.
Yeah.
To slap Mario into it.
He was just in everything back in those days.
He was, and he was F1 racing,
F1
apparently.
Yeah, he fixed his own cars and all this nonsense.
He was on the Wrecking Crew.
Yeah.
You know, he played on those Beach Boy albums.
Stop.
Sorry. As you mentioned earlier, the fluidity of the controls are incredible. I mean, I love the way this game plays.
It is definitely like one of the best feeling NES games on the console, if you ask me.
This is one of my favorite games of all time, for the record. Ever.
Me too. I go back to it so many times.
I love Mike Tyson's Punch-Out.
Whether you play it on the original emulator or whatever. Yeah. Or on the Switch, or you know, whatever options. I mean, it is available now if you do have a Nintendo Switch.
I played this on the original Nintendo console. I had a Nintendo in the mid-90s. I mean, I had it in the early 90s, but I didn't get my hands on this game until the mid-90s because my friend just let me have it. So I played it all the time in the mid-90s, 95, 96, 97. I loved this game. The music that they threw in. Oh my goodness. I just love this game, and so many of you probably do too, and you have memories of playing this and all the different characters. So let's run down the characters for this game, because again, they're, in my opinion, part of what make the game.
They do.
Are these characters.
I just think the roster specifically in this one is like perfect.
It's an all-star lineup
it's
of memorability.
It's very good.
Yes.
Yeah. There's no bad opponent.
No,
you
there's
know?
Not. And this is based on a 3-circuit system, which is kind of like 3 levels, right?
Right.
3 boards,
which
if you
they
will.
Would adopt for the, like, going from
forward.
This one. Yeah.
Yeah. So the minor circuit begins with, once again, Glass Joe.
Right.
Who is still the same character as the first game.
Still big old loser.
Big loser. Yeah, Glass Joe, obviously a play on Glass Jaw. You know,
yeah.
That's the joke.
What's interesting about him, he also, to me, introduces you to the star mechanic.
All
because
of it,
you,
yeah.
Because he allows you to get a lot of them easily.
Yep.
And so it's classic Nintendo, like, using the first level to teach you how to play.
Yeah.
And so, because that's the big addition, right, is this, you can do this super punch thing.
Yeah, it's different than the knockout meter, which is more intuitive. It fills up and then you press the knockout button.
This teaches you, like, oh, if you hit him in a certain spot, you get the star, and then you can hit start and punch him.
Exactly.
Like, and knock him out straight up.
And you learn how to do that.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people probably, as they played the game more and more, would see, how quickly can I knock out Glass Joe? You know what I mean?
Yeah, it becomes like a game. Some people, like, want to knock him out in the first round.
Yeah. And one thing that you're also introduced to when you successfully knock down Glass Joe is there are a couple of different falling animations for the opponent. Sometimes they swivel like from side to side in slow motion. Sometimes they just crash straight backwards.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you don't know if they're going to get up or not. You know, they'll struggle up, they'll sit up, they'll fall back down. And all the sound effects, it all just, it engrosses you in the game immediately, I feel like.
Yeah. you feel like you're in a fight.
Yes, and the music helps with that.
It's immersive. That's the word I'm looking for.
Yes,
right?
Immersive. I was too.
And
yeah.
I think the music helps too, like you said before, because it, whatever that song is, whatever it's called, it just works because
it's not Koji Kondo, by the way.
If you're if you're winning, you feel like you're dominating and you want to go, like the song's kind of
it's got like a Rocky-esque vibe.
You know, it has that like later part. Like, and it's like, it kind of has like a high and a low. So to kind of like go with the vibe of the,
great.
With the fight. Cause if you're losing, you know, like there's like the low end and it just, the song's perfect.
I think it's a great song. So you beat Glass Joe, right? And you move on to your next opponent in the minor circuit. This is a new character, the mustachioed German Von Kaiser.
Von Kaiser.
And he wears pants.
Yes.
Notably. Mm-hmm. And has a mustache. And I think his tell, doesn't he wiggle his mustache? Isn't that his tell?
You know what's funny? I didn't even ever need to know his tell, because if you just keep fucking punching him, he just dies. Like, he's like so easy to...
He's crappy.
Yeah, he's crappy. Like, he has this like punch that's so blatant that you can
where he's like...
Yeah, like he does this like forward punch thing.
Shitty.
It's so easy to dodge that like, it's like you're not even looking for the tells. Like, you're just like, oh, that.
That and guy then, sucks.
Yeah. Like, it's... I feel like he's a second Glass Joe.
He is.
The only thing is he doesn't give up as many stars from what I remember.
That's one thing. They made him difficult enough that you might get punched.
Yeah.
You might have to deal with taking a punch.
You might maybe go down once if you're a little rusty.
Right. So, like, so you learn how to get up. You know, you mash the buttons.
Right, yeah.
One of the things I also want to mention, let's say you don't knock him out in the first round. Remember, there's rounds in this one. So in between rounds, and these are equally memorable, Quinn.
Oh, God, these, yeah.
In between rounds, you get like a little scorecard of what's going on. You see the picture of Doc tapping Mac on the shoulder.
Which,
you know,
if
like,
you hit select, it will give you life.
It'll give you more life.
Which is like just a secret. Like, yes. You're not supposed to know.
Right. It's a little Easter egg.
And Doc's hand will go like faster if you're hitting, to signify you're hitting, because he's like massaging you or whatever.
Massaging you better now.
Yeah.
Why not just do that all the time, Doc?
Yeah.
But anyway, maybe Mickey is better. Maybe you're right. So the opponent will talk some trash in text, right?
Yeah, like, it's awesome.
You smell like my ass or whatever, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And then Doc will say like sometimes good things, but sometimes he'll just invite you to join the Nintendo fan club.
Nintendo fun club.
Fun club.
Yeah,
today.
Not even the fan club.
Yeah,
the club. Whatever that is, the fun club. I always thought that was a typo, because I'm like, there was the Nintendo fan club, wasn't there?
I have no idea. I didn't
was
join
it the
any
fun
club.
Club.
It might have been the fun
Maybe
club.
Maybe it was the fun
Probably
club.
Probably was the fun club. But I love that little touch. That could have been nothing.
Oh yeah, they didn't have to do anything there.
They didn't have to be text, you know, trash talk.
I mean, some of them get really fun. Like, I'll give you a TKO from Tokyo and, like, all this nonsense.
Some of them are really funny later.
They're just stupid.
Yeah. So, I love that little touch, and I wanted to make sure we mentioned that in between rounds. But, okay, so you beat Glass Joe, you beat Von Kaiser, of course.
Right.
Now, you get yourself a title match. That's right.
Title match.
Very well done. It's like we're playing the game, Quinn.
Yeah.
And this is against the minor circuit champion, Piston, not Hurricane, but the Japanese Piston Honda.
Piston Honda.
So they repurposed the character of Piston Hurricane,
mm-hmm.
and pretty much the same, the Hurricane Punch move, which is like an alternating left and right.
Mm-hmm.
They repurpose him into being a Japanese character.
Right.
I don't quite know why they did or not. I don't know what the reason was, but mm-hmm. they did. So Piston Honda is your first true formidable opponent.
Yes, and if I recall, he has kind of like a like uppercut, right?
He does. He has a charging punch.
Yeah.
And he does the hurricane punch.
Right, yeah.
Where
that
foom,
like a piston, right? Like the, you know.
Yeah. It's like we're playing the game.
Yeah.
That was a good sound effect.
Yeah.
Folks, I want you to appreciate Quinn's sound effect there, because I do think it translated to your ears.
There. This is an audio medium.
It is. I think that Piston Honda, The first time ever, I mean, if you play him, you might be like, what the hell? This game is hard.
Yeah, he's the first challenge.
And this is where patterns come into play.
Yeah, and again, he's not hard once you know how to beat him.
No.
He becomes like just like any other opponent. But like,
his tell is the eyebrows.
If it's the first time playing, this is definitely the guy who's going to give you trouble at first, right?
Yep.
And this is also, interestingly enough, this is the whole gameplay loop right here. Is like, you get an easy opponent, you get a medium difficulty opponent, and then you get a hard one.
That's a good point.
Right? And so that's like your first set.
I think that's a good way to put it.
Because then you move to the next if you beat the Honda.
Yeah, so
the Piston.
Let's say you beat the Piston.
Yeah.
And you win the minor circuit championship. Yeah. Well, you are now allowed to move up to the major circuit.
Yes.
Okay?
And you have a title now, Joe.
Now you
got to defend your title against these dorks.
Yep, against these dorks. So in the major circuit, the first guy you're going to meet is another new character from Spain, Don Flamenco.
Whoop!
And he's got a rose between his teeth and all that.
I love his intro.
Yeah, I do too. It's a very classy intro. But
he's basically a Glass Joe, but a little bit better.
He's a little bit better. Yep.
Right.
It's a palette. It's a head swap and a palette swap.
Right. And so that's what I mean about the loop, right?
Yes.
So now you've restarted the loop, okay? He's easier than Honda,
yes,
but he's better than, like, Von Krauser or whatever.
Yeah,
Von Kaiser, whatever his name is.
Von Krausers.
Yeah. Von Krausers.
Von
store.
Braun Civic Center. And so you probably beat him pretty easily because you've beaten Glass Joe and these other people. You get a good handle
kind
on him.
Kind of like a fast uppercut, but that's about it.
Yes, that's about all he has.
Yeah.
Then we have one unique character. He's not palette swapped by anyone else in the rest of the game. He's very clearly a Nintendo humor character. Like, they put him in here just to be funny. From Hippo Island, of course, King Hippo.
King Hippo. But to me, what he represents is one of the first, very large sprites in the game.
Very fat man.
Right? Very fat, very large.
Yes.
But he has one of the coolest patterns where he, like, raises his arms to, like, kind of, like, nail, like, kind of hit you with both of his arms.
Yep.
But when he does that, a lot of these opponents, like, face punch was just really all you needed. You didn't need a body shot.
Yeah.
If you body shot him, he has, like, tape on his belly button, like he got injured or whatever, and then you hit it, and it, like, it destroys
him. Yeah, you can just keep punching him, right?
Like, he gets stunned, and then you can do face punches to him.
Nintendo, again, in the game-making brilliance here, that tape is a fucking target.
Right.
Of course you want to hit the tape if you're a kid and you don't know better.
But you might be unfamiliar with this body shot thing, so I feel like it's also introducing you, because your first instinct, because you've been high punching everyone the whole time, is like, oh, I want to hit it, but then you go over him and you're like, wait, what? And he blocks it too, just to kind of give you that, like, no, you fucked up.
Yeah,
like, you have to do the other punch.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's well designed.
Very well designed, and it breaks up the monotony of the patterns and
right,
stuff like
yeah.
that. It's a different character. He would actually go on to appear in, like, other NES licensed thing. He was actually a pretty popular character because just look at him. Kind of looks like Curly Joe Dorita.
Yeah. He's just iconic because he's so different from, like, everyone, right?
I agree with you.
Yeah.
Then we get to meet Great Tiger again.
Great Tiger.
Virtually unchanged from the arcade.
Yes. Now we're starting to get into the diversity, right? You know, Hippo had hit the body shot, right?
Yep.
Now you cannot avoid having to survive the ultimate attack with Great Tiger.
Yeah, the Tiger Punch.
The Tiger Punch.
Or the Teleport Punch, whatever.
And so basically the trick with him, which is so interesting, and again, now we're introducing another concept, the only way to survive the Tiger Punch is if you block it precisely on all three or four shots, I think.
It's sometimes more, I think.
Yeah, and so if you block all of them, he dizzies himself, and then you can just knock the shit out of him, right?
He's like, and then you just punch him as much as you possibly can.
Right, and if you have a star punch, he gets real fucked up.
Yeah.
Like, if you hit him right off the spins.
He's one of those guys, Quinn, when I used to play this game, and probably to this day, even though I've beaten him, I get nervous when I'm going to fight Great Tiger sometimes because of that fucking teleport punch.
Actually, it's the next opponent that gets me nervous.
Yeah. Whole different story. So, all right, we've made it past the Great Tiger. Guess what? It's time for a title bout.
It's title bout time. So who's the hardest guy in the majors?
Whew! Bald Bull.
Bald Bull. Okay. Bald Bull, he's got a wicked uppercut and a hook, and, like, he's kind of like
charge.
So that's his finisher, right?
Yes.
But first of all, like, his initial shit is annoying.
His jab is hard,
right? Like, everything is just a pain in the he's like fast as fuck, he's huge.
Yeah.
Like, everything is, and it hurts like a fuck ton if you get hit, right?
He is scary.
But my favorite part about him, because it's so damn tense, is so he gets ready for the bull charge, right?
Yes, he charges back.
And now, this is how I was taught. I know that you're supposed to look at the cameraman or whatever the fuck to, like, know when to punch him.
I never did.
It is as easy as counting to three. So he goes back for the bull charge and he'll bounce. On the first bounce, one, two, three, punch, and then you'll and he'll get knocked out from it. It's an instant knockout, no matter how much life he has.
You gut punch him. He's like, and then he falls back.
I love that too, because at that, it's so hard to do any damage to him.
I know,
right? And that is such an awesome like reward, because if. First of all, the tell that is the camera, a lot of people don't even know that.
I didn't know that,
right?
As a kid.
Yeah, I didn't know that either. My friend figured out if you go 1, 2, 3, that rhythm specifically,
yeah,
that you'll always, always get it.
See, I never knew the camera thing as a kid. Yeah. It would have helped me. I just tried to time it.
That was like some instinct. Nintendo Power, like, not even on Nintendo Power, just on the playground shit, like, that I found that out.
Well, hey. Whatever got the job done. But I bet so many people have the thrill of knocking out Bald Bull for the first time.
It is definitely the most thrilling fight to up to that point.
It
right?
is.
It feels like a huge deal when you beat him.
Yes.
Right?
And whether I was age 8 and beat Bald Bull or age 38, which I'm not yet, but I will be, and I'll fight Bald Bull on my 38th birthday.
Fight him.
It will be a huge thrill to defeat Bald Bull.
He feels like a real champion. Like actual like contender.
Yes.
Like, you know what I mean?
It is an accomplishment to beat him.
Yes.
So, you've done it though. You go to the world circuit. And who do you meet there? Well, Piston Honda wants a rematch, first of all.
Yeah, I remember this.
He's pissed off, Honda.
Yeah, so this was very surprising the first time. I'm like, wait, he's back?
And he's harder. Like,
well, yeah, he had to qualify to get into
the world
circuit, whatever. So I guess like while we were split off, he got all pissy and just beat up Sal and Hippo and all that, like the other people.
Sal.
What's his name?
Yeah, he beats Sal.
The Italian guy.
Spanish.
Flamenco, yes.
Don Flamenco.
Yeah.
Pizza pasta,
yeah.
Ravioli mafiosi.
Yeah. But
he beat all those guys.
And he beat Tiger, he beat everyone.
I guess so.
I guess he beat Bald Bull, too.
But guess what? If you're good, he don't beat you.
Yeah.
If you get past him, you get another new character. Well, semi-new character. Remember Vodka Drunkinsky?
Yes, him.
Yeah. You know, Nintendo's a family-friendly company.
It's a family entertainment company,
right,
Joe.
Exactly. Famicom, it's in the name. So they decided, well, he can't be drinking vodka.
No.
That's not a good role model for kids. So he's drinking soda. He's now Soda Popinski.
Yes.
And
love the name, by the way.
It's a great name. It's so stupid. And he drinks the soda in his picture and everything.
It doesn't look like it's great. What soda? What is it? Sprite? What is he drinking?
They just like yeah, he drinks Mountain Dew. They just haphazardly drew Pop on the bottle.
Yeah.
You notice that? Just to like.
It almost feels like at the last second, like somebody over at Nintendo R&D3 was like, oh,
we can't.
like the head of Nintendo came in. He's like, you can't put that in there.
Yeah,
like,
that's a kid's game.
Yeah, what the hell?
So Soda Popinski still makes like vodka, like alcohol references.
Yeah, that's what I mean of how it feels like it was just like taken out at the last second.
Definitely,
yeah.
Definitely. And he can. I remember somebody, they didn't know we were going to do this episode, and I forget who it was, on the group saying that they could never beat Soda Popinski. And you know what? I never had a hard time with him as a kid.
No, because
I don't know why.
I think you know what it is.
What?
So he's basically like a faster version of like flamenco, basically. Like he's just uppercutty and stuff.
Yeah, he doesn't look like flamenco at all.
No,
it's not that, but he's
it's the same kind of like uppercut kind of fight based fighter or whatever.
Right.
He's just faster.
Yeah.
He's one of the tell before the tell kind of guys. Like he's one of the first ones.
Yeah.
But I think that Bald Bull is such a struggle that it feels like he's a come down.
That's
right?
What I always felt too.
Yeah, like
I beat Bald Bull, I can handle this.
Right, exactly. So you have a lot of confidence going into the fight with him.
Right. It's not that
and you beat hard Honda.
Hard Honda, yeah. Pissed off Honda. It's not that Soda Pop's not challenging at all. He is challenging, but he's not. I never had too many problems.
It's the next like set of people that are hell on earth.
Well,
like, they're awful.
It gets hard because
this is where it's after Popinski that I have trouble.
So first of all, you have to fight Bald Bull again after Popinski.
But you know,
but
the
you know
thing,
it.
It's just slightly different. Again, it's not
as bad.
Yeah.
One thing that's surprising is after Bald Bull, I don't know how this guy made it here. But Don Flamenco made it all the way
up. Yeah, that one was also weird.
And he's a big pain in the ass because he blocks everything.
Yeah.
And you lose your hearts and then you're like all purple and you can't punch.
But again, I can handle that.
I can handle it.
Yeah, like they're not terrible, right? These repeat versions, they're never as bad.
No, because you've done it before. They're a little different.
They're just kind of faster and like their patterns like change ever so slightly, but it's not enough to like throw you off your game.
No, because you've beaten their ass before.
Yeah.
And you're going to do it again. And Lord help you if you do, because then you got to deal with Mr. Sandman.
Mm.
And he is scary.
What a bunch of bullshit. Yeah.
He is one of the hardest characters for me in
this game.
He's got the charging uppercuts that'll do in triplets and stuff.
It's fucking horseshit.
They'll knock you the fuck down quick.
Yeah, this guy is no joke.
He is insanely hard.
Yes. Now, he's like, you know what's funny? I always felt he was like a blur to me. He's a fight I don't remember. But I remember all I remember is struggling and like eventually beating him. Like I could not even tell you the pattern because a lot of times when I play casually, I kind of stop after soda because like like I'm just like whatever.
You don't want to play Bald Bull again?
Yeah, exactly. Because I've beaten the game before.
Sure. But Sandman, oh my god,
he's the
intimidation factor.
If you've beaten the game before, he's the one where you're like, okay, I'm done for the night.
Yeah. This shit's hard, man.
Yeah.
I should also mention here real quick before we move on to the next opponent that between circuits, we get that training montage.
You gotta train. Right? You gotta go jogging, Joe.
So it's Mac in like a hoodie.
Yeah.
And he's running behind Doc, who is on a bike.
Yes.
And they're in front of the Statue of Liberty. And then you get a password.
Yeah, so there's like a saving feature, essentially. But it only brings you up to the circuit you were at, where you got the password.
But at least it allows you to come back and keep your record up to that circuit.
Correct.
Which is useful, as we will see in a little bit. So if you've made it past Mr. Sandman, it is now time to fight the champion of the world circuit, the final boss from Super Punch-Out, Super Macho Man.
This guy's a total piece of shit, Joe. This is the one that I hated the most.
What makes him hard?
He is so fast, and we're talking like, you gotta dodge before he even tells.
Yeah.
Like, you gotta, like, he is ludicrous. Like, talk about turning the speed up.
Yeah, he's insane.
Like, it's all speed. That's what it is.
He is really hard if you've never played him before, and you're just like, what did I walk into here? And he does the spinning punches.
He'll knock you out in like 2 seconds, too. Like, he doesn't even fuck around. Like, he just starts going, like, right? He just starts uppercutting you and shit.
Yeah,
he has, like, this whoosh, 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 like, triple. You're like, what the fuck? You gotta do this, like, dodging, like, left to the right, you know, all in a row. Like, you barely get an opening ever.
It's exhausting playing him. It is!
It's basically like, you have to survive his combo, essentially.
Yeah.
And then you can go. Then it's your turn, right? And it's like, that's the thing is, it's not like, oh, I dodged him once, now I can do something.
No,
it's like, no you got to dodge this, that, and
oh, God.
A bunch of bullshit, and it's all fast.
It'd make you wish you were still fighting Von Kaiser.
Yeah.
Let me just put it that way.
If I make it past Sandman and I make it to him, he's the real, like,
he's scary.
Fuck you.
No, like, fuck you is right.
Yeah.
Now,
like, people always talk shit like how Tyson's so good, but like, fuck, Super Macho Man's like insane.
Now, to even get to Tyson, we should mention, to even get to this point, you need to have a perfect record through all the circuits, which is where the password comes in handy.
Right.
Because you can obviously, if you lose, fine, reset the game and go back with your password.
Right.
And do it until you have a perfect record.
I guess ideally you want to get to like the world circuit.
Yes,
right.
And then just until you're undefeated in it.
Yeah.
Now, there is a Tyson password. They don't give that to you. You can find that out. You know, there was one to go right to Tyson, which I was able to get a hold of and I used in my later career.
I did
career.
Do that to fight him.
So,
because Super Macho Man's such a piece of shit. There's no way I'm getting through that on the first try.
It's hard.
Yeah.
So, Mike Tyson, if you've ever played Mike Tyson, you know that his sprite is unique and it's awesome and it looks like Mike Tyson. It's pretty good, right?
He's also like next to impossible.
One punch from him knocks you down.
Yes.
Which is very realistic because one punch from Mike Tyson in real life would knock me down.
He's a knockout artist.
Yeah.
Like, you know, to the touch.
Yes.
Like, you do not get touched by Mike Tyson.
So, like, you know, okay, Super Macho Man does an uppercut. You're not getting knocked down after one uppercut.
No.
With full energy.
I mean, you take pretty a hell of a lot of damage.
Yeah.
But
Tyson, one uppercut, you're dead.
Yeah.
Like, you're three uppercuts, game over.
Yeah.
When you finally manage to beat Mike Tyson, if you ever have.
Can we just talk about that in the first place, right? By the way, like,
go
that,
ahead.
The fact that it is rare to meet people who have beaten Mike Tyson. I don't know if I beat him or use save states or something.
On the
like,
console.
I could not. I don't think I legit beat Mike Tyson ever.
I legit beat Mike Tyson.
Without a code or any of that.
I beat him. Now, it was very friggin' hard.
Yeah.
And I've been playing the game a real while. That's probably 10.
But that's the thing, is you're an exception. That's
it's
what's
hard!
So, that, to me, is what's so legendary about him as a boss in video games in general.
Yeah.
Is that he is, like, legitimately, like, very, very, very difficult.
Hard, yeah.
He is no fucking joke.
No, he's not.
He's kind of a challenge boss. He's not even, like, to me, really the boss as much as he's like, oh, congratulations, you beat everyone. Like,
yeah, now you get to fight Mike Tyson.
Now really test your skills,
yeah,
right?
That's
what he is.
They call it the dream fight.
Right, exactly.
In the game. Okay. If you've ever beat Mike Tyson, let us know. If you've ever made it to Tyson,
there needs to be a poll. Have you ever beaten Mike? Because, I mean, I feel like it would be like 50-50, right?
Yeah, I really don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. But man, is it hard.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I want to briefly mention, if you beat Mike Tyson, you get a password for what's called Another World Circuit, and it's nothing special, but if I didn't mention it, people might ask why.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the same opponents in a different order. It's Hippo, Tiger, Honda, Soda Popinski, Bald Bull, Don Flamenco, Sandman, and Super Macho Man. Okay? And then Tyson. It's not anything.
Yes.
It doesn't count. It's not canon. Okay?
It's fake.
It's fake. But needless to say, the fact that we're talking about this game, it was a rousing success for Nintendo.
Mm-hmm.
It achieved 2 million copies sold by 1988.
Wow.
The other game that did so that year was The Legend of Zelda.
Of course it did.
Which came out a year prior.
Yeah, the Zelda, you know, it's funny, Zelda, you know, it's still selling like shit tons.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. So, very successful game, the most fondly remembered, I'd say. And a footnote to this whole thing with Mike Tyson in real life, we had mentioned that Tyson had three belts when they were developing the game, right?
Mm-hmm.
However, Quinn, you were recently informed through conversation with our noted boxing expert, Tony Leg Day Duva, that there's the lineal champion as well.
Yes, lineal.
And the rookie...
Which is the only one that should matter. I don't understand all this belt stuff.
Well, I guess a lot of people still considered Michael Spinks the lineal champion, who was an undefeated boxer, by the way, and a legitimate boxer. So anyway, they have this big fight in the Fear Box, if any know, this June of 1988 in Atlantic City Convention Center,
mm-hmm.
convention dump over there, that where WrestleMania 4 and 5 were. This was a very anticipated fight, not on the level of the fight of the century with Ali and Frazier in 71.
But essentially, this would cement Tyson's legacy as like, no, he's like, he was the real world champion, like not all these other companies or whatever they are.
Knocked out Michael Spinks in 90 seconds.
Yep, so there you go. Now he's the legit champion.
Yes.
He's not going to make it. It's all over.
This is the height, some would say, of Tyson's career. But what you have to remember is his name recognition now with Nintendo is through the freaking roof in 88.
Yep, so selling copies are flying off the shelves for Mike Tyson's Punch-Out.
And then Tyson, if you recall, had signed a licensing agreement. And those agreements obviously have an end date. Okay.
Right.
They're not indefinite.
This is why, to me, it's still rare to this day Nintendo signs licensing agreements, right? Because they got boned here.
Well, they kind of got boned. So his deal expired at the end of 1989.
Yeah.
He had signed it, I think, at the end of 86 or 87, whatever it was. There are misconceptions that they dropped Tyson because he lost to Buster Douglas in 1990.
Mm-hmm.
That's not why. Or that because he had rape allegations or convictions. Also not why. The reason,
you would think it would be that.
Right, but
because
wasn't.
Nintendo and wholesome family entertainment or whatever.
It was simply that the deal expired, and it would be a lot more expensive to re-sign him in 1989 when he was the undisputed
champion.
And the game was 2 years old.
Right.
And we're not going to do this again.
It's also just not how games worked back then. They didn't think of, like... I mean, they didn't even keep the code sometimes. They would just throw it in and delete it off their computer.
Right. But they still saw some kind of bankability. So maybe you are one of these people that have played a version of Punch-Out without Mike Tyson. It's just known as Punch-Out, and it has crappier artwork, and it's like bluish or something. And it came out in August of 1990 in the United States. The only difference in this game is that instead of Mike Tyson, you have Mr. Dream, and... I have a theory, and I don't know if anyone has ever confirmed this, and maybe they have, but I haven't heard it.
God, do you think he's supposed to be some other person?
Well, they say that he's based off the way Rocky Marciano looked, but that's not it. I have a theory that they call him Mr. Dream Because if you recall, when you fight Mike Tyson,
yeah,
it says in big letters, Dream Fight, and it's called Dream Circuit, and they didn't want to redo that. So they called the character Mr.
Just
Dream.
Just generically, like,
yes.
He is Mr. Dream.
Yes, because it's like...
Almost, he's the Dream Fight.
Yes.
I don't think that's much of a theory as much as it's probably just true.
That's what,
like,
I'm saying.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't think it's like... It doesn't
never
seem
heard
that
of
mysterious.
It.
You know?
I never looked into it is what I mean. But it's got to be, right?
But overall, for the folks at home, this is just a palette swappy.
Yes.
Has the same exact pattern, like,
yes,
everything.
Same,
like,
moves.
Is it he one punch knocked out,
yeah,
all that?
Yeah, it's the same thing.
You're not losing out. It's just the sprite's different.
He just looks like a big dork.
Yeah.
He does.
He looks like, crappier.
He looks like a weenie.
Yeah.
But we have to mention another spinoff of sorts of Punch Out here before we move on to Super Nintendo. Power Punch 2.
Now, don't. This is horrible.
We have
Joe.
To bring it up, Quinn. So this came out in...
no.
In June of 1992.
This stinks.
And Power Punch 2 was originally developed.
I hate this game.
I need to mention this. So they were originally... Beam Software, not Nintendo. Beam Software.
That's how you know.
That's how you know. Was originally going to use Mike Tyson in a new boxing game. Mm-hmm. It was not a Punch-Out sequel, folks, okay? It wasn't. But a boxing game, because Mike Tyson is, in fact, a boxer, right?
Now, what was Power Punch 1?
There wasn't one, and I'll explain it. So, the original idea was Mike Tyson's intergalactic Power Punch.
Yes.
And he was going to travel to... You play as Tyson.
Yeah, you go to space and fight aliens and shit.
So he could not only be the best in the world, but the
best in the universe or galaxy or whatever.
And then the rape conviction.
Yep.
So that's where this actually comes into play.
Actually come out, or is this some ROM hack shit that I played?
This
because
came
I definitely
out.
Played this.
Okay, so the game was released as Power Punch 2. I don't know why the 2. And the artwork features a boxer that is not Mike Tyson, but clearly was supposed to be, and they altered it.
Come on. I'm looking right at
it. That's what I'm
saying. That's fucking Mike Tyson. What do they think? We're stupid?
And the in-game sprite, same deal. And they changed the name of the character and any reference in the game from Mike Tyson to Mark Tyler.
It's horrible. It's so bad.
And the biggest problem of all of it is the game is terrible. Like, if you've ever played the game, it's really, really bad.
It's really shitty.
It's not anywhere on the level of Punch-Out.
It's awful. Like, I feel like the characters don't react to punches properly
shit. The engine is crap. Yeah. So I just want to be very clear that this wasn't...
The graphics suck my ass.
The graphics suck Quinn's ass.
They're awful. They're so bad.
I just want to...
It upsets me, Joe.
I just want to be fair.
I'm sorry for being vulgar, everyone, but it's terrible. Awful. Why are we even talking about this one?
We have to. It's our diligence. Now, there was a prototype that you could play on emulation. Someone found the Mike Tyson version. So if you want
what
to...
What is this?
If you want to play...
Power Punch 1, I say.
That's Power Punch 1, exactly. And Mike Tyson's
that
name...
nobody ever played.
...is in it. So there you go.
Oh, my goodness.
Had to mention that. Okay.
Okay, so now on to the lineal champion of Punch-Out, Super Punch-Out,
exactly,
right?
Because Power Punch 2 is a Michael Spinks here. It got knocked out. Super Punch-Out, Super Nintendo, many of you maybe grew up with this one.
Mm-hmm.
I certainly played my fair share of it. This was a sequel developed for Super Nintendo, released in North America in September of 94, released in Europe in January of 95, and Japan in March of 1998...
What?
Via the kiosk, like, flash RAM thing they were doing.
Oh, the thing where you bring a cartridge and they... Wait a sec. This didn't have, like, a retail release in Japan?
No! I guess it was a U.S.-made game.
I know that thing at the end of life of SNES was very popular in Japan.
SNES,
whatever, SNES. Like, that like, kiosk thing was actually, like, extremely popular.
So maybe they figured we can make money.
Yeah.
Throwing
it's just weird that they didn't release it in 94
I know.
In Japan.
It's weird. It's really weird. So this game, we need to clarify. If you had only grown up playing Mike Tyson's Punch-Out or regular for Nintendo, and then you played this, you're like, wait, this is really different.
It is.
The reason is because this is based on the arcade version.
Right.
Because SNES can do it.
So before we even get into it, my feelings on this were like, this was never my favorite. I
didn't like it as much. But I liked it a lot.
It feels like heavier or something. Like, it's not the same.
It's not the same.
I feel like a lot of the characters don't even, like, they're well animated and stuff.
Oh, they're really well done.
There's not a heft to like when you land punches or something, in my opinion. I can't explain it.
It might be the sound effect. It's too like smacky or something. It's like
it's weird, yeah. I don't know how else to put it. And here's the thing is I know people really love this version of the game.
I love it.
But this my own personal opinion is I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
I can never put my precise finger on it because everything about this game visually is better.
Oh yeah.
It's
incredible.
It's got 16 bits, Joe. So it's better.
Double the bits, Quinn.
It's got double the bits.
It's got good music.
It's got good bits and music. It's got more music.
More voice samples and stuff like that. It's really well done.
It's got Sony sound chip music.
It does have sound chip music and more bits, like we mentioned.
Yeah.
Now, the main character here is a blonde-haired boxer that, again, sometimes is retconned into being Little Mac,
That's not him.
It's not, and it's never said to be by Nintendo, but sometimes it is said to be.
They even revised that shit in Wii.
Yeah.
He's like, that's not what he looks like.
He doesn't look like that. So, I have a couple of problems with this, and it starts with the first character. I think that we should have gotten a 16-bit glass Joe. For all the ass-kickings...
This is really upsetting you,
huh? Yeah, for all the ass-kickings this guy took, we get the guy that Glass Joe trained, Gabby J.
Gabby J. Yay.
Yay.
Gabby J.
Yay.
Glass Joe trained him
because
he's old as crap.
Well, I mean, Glass Joe's not a smart guy.
I thought it was the other way around, that this guy trained Glass Joe.
No, and the only win that Gabby J got was against Glass Joe. He's 1-99.
Wow, Glass Joe stinks so much that the old man that he trained beat him.
Yeah, he's like 56 or something.
Yeah.
It's horrible, but he plays like Glass Joe. It's the same thing.
It's the same. Well, he learned everything from him.
Exactly. Bear Hugger is next, and he is very... comically cute in this game.
I like him.
Like, if you punch him in the stomach, he's like
he's got a King Hippo vibe to him.
He does.
Yeah.
Right? And then, hey, making his return, Piston Hurricane.
Oh, there he is.
See? So Piston Honda gone. Hurricane is returned.
This game is cool because the guys that we missed out on in the NES.
Yeah, you get some of them.
They come back.
Bald Bull is in the minor circuit this time. He's the champion of the minor.
Yeah.
He is more minor, and he's not as hard.
I always thought this was a result, though, of, like, the pattern is, like, almost the same.
Yeah.
Like, it's very similar.
There's a couple of new moves that he does. He does, like, a short bull charge.
A couple. But if you beat him,
yep.
he's not the same challenge he once was.
He isn't.
Yeah.
No, and he's not supposed to be. He's not as difficult.
Right.
And that's the minor circuit. I also want to mention we're down to one round again, like the arcade. One three-minute round.
Mm.
Which I didn't like as much.
I didn't like that either.
The
three rounds made it tense as hell.
I know.
Yeah.
KO meter has replaced the star punch again. So again, when I'm a kid, I had never played the arcade version yet. So to me, this was all new. And I was like, why did they change all this?
This game was very confusing to me as well.
But I didn't realize that they were really just porting the arcade version over. So
this is like, we're finally getting to like do this, right? We have the power now. Nintendo power, the 16 bits of power, Joe.
16 bits, okay.
Yeah.
In the major circuit, we got a new character, Bob Charlie from Jamaica.
Bob Charlie!
If you can't guess who that's supposed to be
mm-hmm.
and whose name that rhymes with, I am not telling you. You can guess. just put it that way. He's not that hard.
He stinks.
He likes reggae.
It's the classic, though. It's like I said in the original, the loop of like, okay, now you kind of like restart in difficulty again.
Yeah, he's the Don Flamenco.
Yeah,
basically.
Exactly.
Dragon Chan returns from Super Punch-Out, and he still kicks, and he's still annoying.
He
can be a pain in the butt.
Really annoying.
Yeah, like, right?
It's jumping all over the ring thing he does, too, final move.
He can be very irritating.
Very irritating.
Yes. We got a new character, a masked luchador from Mexico.
That was pretty fast, from my memory.
Yeah, masked muscle. So he's a wrestler that's boxing.
Masked muscle!
And he's quick. Yeah, he's got a lot of quick moves. He also does the mist, the illegal mist.
Oh, no, yeah. He always... Every time I play this game, I forget he has it, and he gets me every time. I'm like, he starts to do it. I'm like, wait, what? What do I do?
It's very, very funny, though, that they put a fucking master wrestler in a game. I don't know why. It tickles me.
Well, they did have the wrestler types before.
Superstar Billy Graham.
Yeah, exactly.
And then the champion of the major circuit is Mr. Sandman.
This felt like a freaking wall of unfair for some reason to put him at this point in the game.
He's hard, man.
This Mr. Sandman just never gets easier.
He might be one of the best overall opponents, right? Because he's so fucking hard.
He's the wall in this game, no doubt.
He is, and he's like I don't know if he's harder than in Tyson's punch out, but
yeah.
It might be the same.
Yeah.
He's difficult.
It's pretty tough.
But if you beat him, you go to the world circuit. New character from Ireland, Dublin, Aaron Ryan.
Aaron Ryan!
This guy isn't hard, though, from my memory. Again.
He can be because he does like a move where he like shakes you.
Honestly, this is the last opponent before I really don't like this game.
It gets difficult.
Because this next dude.
Yes. So we,
so annoying.
We have, from Osaka, Japan,
mm-hmm.
We have a Kabuki, I guess, character.
I guess, yeah. I guess it's like Kagero. The best way to describe it. Yeah.
Heike Kagero!
He's got long-ass hair that he whips you with and does, like, head whip moves.
This guy is a pain in the balls.
Fucking pain in
this
the balls.
This is when it's like, it was already enough to deal with the kicking guy. This right. guy's doing weird shit, and this is where I, like, just want to throw my damn controller at this right. point. Like, this is where this game, like, really frustrates the shit out of me.
It is frustrating. Good thing for save states. Good yeah. thing for yes. save states on Super Nintendo, because how many bits?
16.
Yeah. So if you beat Heike Kagero, you move on to from Milan, Italy, because opera.
this character is stupid.
A palette swap and a head swap of Bear Hugger, same body. Mad Clown.
Mad Clown!
Dumb. Like I said, this circuit is like, I hate this
Mad
circuit.
Mad Clown's hard. He throws yeah. balls at your face.
This shit sucks. Like, this whole, like, the third circuit is just... awful. I don't even know if I've made it past it ever.
It's difficult.
Yeah.
It is difficult.
Because it's frustrating because there's like a lot more people after it. So you feel like you get to this point in the game and they just like cut you off.
They fuck with you.
Yeah.
Now, if you do happen to get past Mad Clown, don't worry. It gets easier. All you got to do is beat the champion of the world circuit, Super Macho Man.
Yeah, just like it's nothing, right? Yeah. Like, let's just throw this asshole back at you.
And as always, very hard.
Just the worst.
And then, kind of like how to get to Tyson, you have yeah. to get all three undefeated.
Mm-hmm.
If you do it in Super Punch-Out, and again, save states. If you do it in Super Punch-Out, you get to the special circuit.
Now, all these people look like they're from Dragon Ball Z or something. Yeah. Like, what are
these? All these people are a pain in my balls. Yeah. So you start with the 20-year-old Londoner, Narcus Prince. And his gimmick is that you can't hit him in the face. He blocks it until you do the right stun move. And
so he's like Vega or something.
He's kind of like Vega, yeah. yeah. And then when you do hit him in the face, he's like a big baby about it.
Yeah.
Narcus Prince!
And if you beat him, you have to fight from Beijing, China, Hoi Carlo.
Hoi Carlo!
He uses his stick!
He's like an old man. He's like that
is he,
no, you know, from like those kung fu movies yeah, the old guy trains the kid
yes,
or whatever.
That's what he
yeah,
is.
Yeah, that's exactly what he is. He's the old kung fu master.
He's the old kung fu
who's
master.
He's like super dangerous.
Yes. Beats you up with his stick, his cane, whatever.
Yeah.
It's unfair. And then the two final opponents are the bruisers.
Who literally
bruisers.
Look like they're freaking Majin Buu from Dragon Ball or some crap. What, like, they look like they were animated by that Toriyama guy.
Well,
like,
maybe they were. I don't know.
They might have been. It's too similar.
So you have Rick Bruiser, a bald with an earring. Look, kind of yeah. like Mr. Clean. A bald boxer. Very, very difficult.
Rick Bruiser.
He only has one loss in his record, and it is to his older brother, the champion of the special circuit, Nick Bruiser.
Nick Bruiser!
These guys are pains in the ass.
No offense, this is kind of like anticlimactic.
It is.
Like two brothers, like really?
Yeah, the Bruiser brothers.
Dumb.
I got a confession.
I don't know. This game, it's good.
Yeah.
But it's just...
It's not... Doesn't have the charm?
It just... Yeah, it's just like... the first half is really fun, and then it just becomes... just a pain in the balls like yeah. for the rest of it. It really does.
It's very hard. The special yeah. circuit is really hard. I got a confession to make. Even though I beat Tyson, legit beat Tyson, on the actual console, on the few times I was able to make it to Rick Bruiser, I was already fucking spent, and I'm like, I can't figure out how to beat this guy. So I never made it to Nick. In my ZSNES days, mm-hmm. I save stated and rewound, you know,
yeah,
hell out of it.
Yeah, just kept going. Yeah.
And I beat Rick and I beat
just
Nick.
Attrition.
Yes.
Like, yeah.
But I've never beaten Nick Bruiser or Rick Bruiser legitimately.
Yeah. Don't worry, Joe. I haven't either.
Okay. I know
like
that
I said,
Tony
Lydia
has.
This is the one where it's just like, I just find
yep.
this second half just horrible.
It's very difficult like, yeah. after Heike Kagero. Or maybe yeah. once you get on to Heike Kagero.
Heike Kagero is like the one.
Yes.
Like he's the one where you're like, I hate this game.
Yeah.
Like, I fucking hate this game.
Now, the reaction to this game in 94, it was actually successful, well-reviewed, but I think the overall consensus is it's lacking a certain something.
I think it's mostly also unbalancedness. Like, I feel like the difficulty spike is way too early.
Yeah?
That's my personal take on it.
You might be like, right.
I think it gets too hard too quick.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Unlike the other one, that it kind of ramps up perfectly. Like, the other one really doesn't get hard until, like, the last three or four guys.
That's true.
Like, this is, like, there's, like, seven people left by the time, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's
like,
hard.
But it's, like, it's only, like, you're only, like, 50% through, and it just throws everything at you at that point.
That's fair, Quinn. I think also, and maybe I'm wrong, folks, I want to know what you think. If you grew up playing Tyson's, and then you played this, you probably are going to like Tyson's more. Maybe not. However, if you just started cold with this, I could totally see this being your favorite Punch-Out.
Yeah, I could see that too. Also, you'd be young and you could just spend all the time in the world doing this. But I didn't even have the card of this. I only had the ROM.
I only rented it. I never owned it.
Yeah,
I definitely rented this game, but I didn't own it.
Either.
Well, there was one more version. 15 years later, they brought it to Nintendo Wii.
Can we say this about this game?
Yes.
This is more of a tribute game than it is, like, I know, like, it's good. It's not, like, a bad game or anything.
Yeah, yeah.
But it definitely, like, it reeks of, this is for the people who liked the original, like, this is a tribute kind of situation,
I mean,
right?
You and I were very interested in it when it came out.
Right, because it was just, like, just so cool that they were, like, even making another one.
Yeah,
right?
And they updated all the characters for the Wii, obviously, and they're goofy and they're funny, and we're just going to briefly run down the roster here. It's almost everyone that is from an existing game, so thankfully Glass Joe is back, not Gabby J.
Yay.
Von Kaiser, the number two again. See, I like that
they do that on the first two,
Now, the number three here is the only new character, Disco Kid, who is kind of, I guess, the equivalent replacement of Kid Quick.
Oh, okay.
Similar in gameplay.
Interesting, yeah.
But it is a new character.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you'd think they'd throw in a lot of new people, right?
Yeah, but they didn't.
Yeah.
King Hippo in the minor circuit. Then into the major, it is the renamed Piston Hondo. They did that to avoid issues with Honda.
Honda's like, hey,
like
you're using our name here.
Yeah,
right?
Can you stop?
Yeah.
Bear Hugger with a nice clean shaven head this time and a beard.
A little too clean for my liking.
Yeah, not husky, not grizzly enough. Yeah. Great Tiger. Don Flamenco with Rose in mouth, of course. Surprisingly, Aaron Ryan.
That's a weird return.
He's
like
shitty.
Nobody even cared.
I know.
Like, you know why you don't remember him? Because the next fighter, the Hooray Kakawa or whoever, like, stinks. Oh, and I just remember him as the last time I give a shit. Like,
they're going to use someone from Super, but use Mass Muscle or somebody.
I don't know.
Mad Clown. Anyway.
Don't use Mad Clown.
Why?
I don't like him.
Okay, sorry. After Aaron Ryan is Soda Popinski.
Mm-hmm.
Then Bald Bull making a triumphant return.
He's pretty deep in the game.
Yeah, well, he deserves to be.
Yeah,
and then the last two guys here, Super Macho Man,
right,
and the final boss, and this is fitting. We've been talking about him the whole run here, Mr. Sandman.
He's been an MVP. Like,
he has been.
He gets to be the champion finally.
Yep, and then they have, which is really cool, alternate artwork for all your title defenses. So, in your defenses, you're going to fight Glass Joe, but with headgear.
Right.
It was very funny. Von Kaiser with a haircut.
I thought this was such a cool, like, the little spin at the end, right? Where you fight them all again to defend your belt.
Yep. Disco Kid, but with, like, a blondish hair. King Hippo with a larger, stupider crown.
Right.
Piston Hondo with a different headband.
Hondo.
Bear Hugger with a hat.
Yeah, he looks like Seamus or something.
Hat. Great Tiger, but I don't know what they changed about
him. There's literally nothing different. I don't understand. It's probably just his pattern.
Yeah. Don Flamenco just looks angrier.
His rose is burnt out, though, or something. Like,
yeah,
it's all messed up.
It's wilted.
Yeah.
Aaron Ryan, shitty.
Not different.
Yeah.
Like, it's the exact same pose.
Soda Pop, Bald Bull, Super Macho, Mr. Sandman, and then, guess what?
What?
Donkey Kong.
Yeah, so Donkey Kong is just in the game. Hey, you might as well pay tribute to where all this shit started for Nintendo, right?
Yeah.
And we should put him in the game.
And you mentioned earlier, Quinn, that that they got it right with Wii. Little Mac is the character, like, officially.
Yeah.
Green gloves, black hair, black tank top.
And this would be the version they would eventually use for, like, Smash Brothers. And, yes. like, this is how he's, like, looks in, like, Nintendo canon, like, as outside of the Punch-Out series.
Exactly. And Doc Lewis is in the game. And they also made a DLC slash, like, I don't know, it was part of some Nintendo Platinum fan club thing.
The fun club fun of, club. Like, back then or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, they did have it on Wii, which was kind of funny. They like, brought it back, and you got this, like, version of it.
Doc Lewis's Punch-Out.
It's weird.
Hey, it is what it is. This game was well done.
Well-received at the
well
time.
Well-received.
Yeah. It just was very tribute. Like, I feel like it's not treated with as much seriousness. It's more for, like, the fans. Like, it's like it's not like a serious, like, we're innovating anything.
No.
It's like,
well, it was a good use of the Wii technology, right? To do
plus
a game
you
like
could,
this.
Yeah, and you could play it just controller wise too if you liked.
Yep.
They didn't, like, force you to use the motion.
Thank God, because I played it with the control.
Yeah.
I played it. But,
I did try it with the motion when
so
we first
I.
got it.
It's
but
fun.
Then, yeah.
But I mean, I'd rather play it with the regular control.
Yeah.
I think overall, these Punch-Out games, though, all of them, are fun.
Super fun.
Right? I mean, really.
They're just a good time. And like I said, I like that they're puzzly. That's what I always liked about them.
They make you think, but they make you feel. They bring out some kind of visceral reaction, whether it's fear of imminent danger or just the thrill of victory in certain situations.
And overall, it's just classic great game design from Nintendo. Like it's quintessential, like, Nintendo. Like, you can tell this is a Nintendo game.
From the character design to the music to the gameplay to the little intricacies and the details.
Yeah, all the little details and stuff.
The quirks, yeah.
And even to the fact that, like, even later down the line, they made kind of more of a tribute game.
Yeah.
Like, that, like, you know, older fans could pick up and be like, oh, yeah, it's back, baby.
It's back,
right?
Yeah.
Like, and I just think they are due, in my book, to kind of, like, bring it back and maybe put some new fighters in it or something like that. And, you know, we're getting to the end of the Switch. Maybe the Switch 2 or one of those.
Hey.
They could make a new Punch-Out game.
We had, 15 years between games? Next year will be 15
years.
I think we're due, right?
I think we're
due.
Like, let's launch that new Switch with the Punch-Out.
You think it has a future? I think it has a future. I think they could do it again.
Yeah, it's not, like, definitely one of their, like, franchises that they're going to make it. And it's like Zelda sells, like, 10 million like, 3 days or
it's
some
different.
Shit. It's like, it's not doing that, but I think it's a great little, like, hey, in between, like, some of their bigger releases, they could throw a Punch out there.
It's not even one of their biggest franchises ever.
Yeah.
But it's one of their
beloved.
Most beloved. Yeah. It's one of the most beloved. It's one of the most memorable, and I love it. One of my favorite Nintendo games is Mike Tyson's Punch Out ever.
Yeah. The first one, definitely.
Literally ever.
Yeah.
And we hope that we conveyed our enjoyment of this series to you. Maybe you learned a thing or two. And if we forgot anything, we apologize, obviously. But let us know, did you beat Tyson? Which Punch-Out game was your
favorite?
Feels
like it needs to be the poll.
Yeah, I think it should be. I think we should have a few polls on this one. Let us know all these things. Make sure you follow us at AWM Podcast on Twitter and join our Facebook group. And let us know your thoughts and feelings on Punch-Out, any and all versions that you played.
Man, what's your favorite?
What's your favorite? Frank Bruno's boxing?
Don't bring that up.
Power Punch 2? I don't know. We'll have to find
the arcade.
The arcade, maybe.
Yeah.
But one way or another, thank you for being with us here. We, of course, will be back next week for something, guess what? Completely different.
Mm-hmm.
Until that time, my name is Joe Morata. That is Michael Quinn, and we will see you next week.
See ya.
Like what you heard? Be sure to leave a review and subscribe on your favorite podcast app. We will see you next week.